ओके, वेलकम टू जेसी कनेक्ट। द प्रीवियस क्लास वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द सैम्पलिंग। देयर वी हैव डिस्कस्ड ग्राम सैम्पलिंग, कंपोजिट सैम्पलिंग। देयर आर टू मेन सैम्पलिंग टेक्निक्स फॉर द कलेक्शन ऑफ द सैम्पल्स फ्रॉम रिवर्स। When it comes to the groundwater, so groundwater also you can apply the same methods if you have more than two or three points. And also we have discussed the some of the very good concepts of preparation of chemicals, the strength of the solution or strength of water or how exactly it can be calculated. So we have discussed the normality, molarity and molality. So let's start with the one by one experiment. That is, first one experiment is pH. So of course pH is termed universally and express the intensity of acid or alkaline condition of the solution. So what is its main thing is that it will show by seeing the pH value, you can say that whether it is the acid or alkaline range. So it is the, if I tell you to define it, so it is the measure of hydrogen ion activity in a solution. It is nothing but it is the measure of hydrogen ion activity, or it is defined as the negative log of base 10 of the hydrogen ion concentration. This is very important. Most of the time you will use log base E, but of course the conversion is there from log base to the 10 to base to the E, conversion is there. But whenever you are defining, okay, define it to the log base to the 10. So in pure water is a balanced combination of hydrogen ion with a positive charge and hydroxyl ion with a negative charge. So if I say the water, so I can write it in this way, H plus plus OH minus. This is, of course, we know that it is hydrogen is a plus and is a hydroxyl. And the water is always balanced with this. It is well balanced with H plus ions and OH minus ions. Always the concentration of both these hydrogen and hydroxyl ion in the pure water. If you take pure water, very important, this term is pure water, is 7 mole per liter. Means here also it will be 7 molar. This one is also 7 molar. So this is nothing but moles per liter. I can use the moles per liter, or sometimes I can use directly moles, or I can use molar. All are same. Okay. Don't be under the only it is mole per liter, mole per. It's common they will use it as molar or moles per liter. So if you take any pure water, it is having the 7 molar of H plus ions and the 7 molar of OH minus ions. So it is positive charge and it is negative charge. So therefore, if you take that according to our relation, what it is saying, the pure water, it is equal to negative log base to the 10 H plus ion concentration. Why we'll take only this H? Why can't we define it in terms of OH? What exactly the thing? Always, if H plus ions is increasing, suppose if it is increasing, pH will come down. If H plus ions, if it is decreasing, suppose if your H plus ion, if it is decreasing, your pH will rise. So
that you have to keep it in mind always.
So then substitute only the h here. Very simple. I already did it. So negative log of, so h plus ion concentration. Usually the concentration, I already said that. Strength of the solution or the concentration, all the terms are same. I can use strength of the solution or concentration, all are same. So substitute here as 10 base to the power of, it is the 10 power minus 7.
So then
if you take that, so I'll get the
7th concentration. So of course, why it has come 10 power minus 7 and all those things,
we'll take it later how exactly the calculation has to be done. As for now,
what you can do, it is always log to the base 10. So h plus ion, always it will be 7 molar concentration. Okay, so then it will come as the pH of the neutral water, that is equal to 7. Maybe you might have already learned this. In your POC, that relation also you might be knowing. What is that? pH plus pOH is equal to 14. That kind of relations
that you already learned.
Okay. So we'll see that how, why they have substituted 10 power minus 7. So addition, we'll take one or two problems, then only we'll come to know. So addition of an acid or water increases the hydrogen and concentration in water, hence the pH will less than 7. Addition of the base will increase the hydroxyl ion concentration. Okay, this is very important. I already listed some of the acids and some of the bases. So acids, I already given three main: HCl, H2SO4, HNO3. Rakesh. Already listed the acid HCl, H2SO4, HNO3. Then basis is NaOH, CH3, OH. What this one? It is NaOH. Then some of the intake MgOH minus. Which twice is also fine, but strong base is the NaOH. So here it will be written as Na plus and OH minus. So here this is nothing but hydroxyl ion. So even if H is increasing, so the pH will increase. Sorry, pH will decrease. Remember this relation. If OH is increasing, then your pH will increase.
Very important.
If H is increasing, pH will decrease. This is a reverse relation. If OH is increasing, your pH will increase. So then, in addition of the base means it is
the NaOH will increase the hydroxyl ion, reduces the hydrogen ion concentration. Very important. It will reduces the hydrogen ion concentration. Very important. Hence, the pH value will increase. See here, pH value is increasing and hydrogen ion concentration is decreasing. Don't confuse with all the other things. Okay. When, see, most of the time, this is what the confusion they will make in the problem. Okay. So, addition of base will increase the hydroxyl ion concentration. Of course, it has to reduce the H. That is the thing. Hence, the pH value will increase. That we already did. That I already said the relation here. Remember, hydrogen ion concentration and hydroxyl ion concentration. pH value increases or decreases. That three things you have to maybe, you have to understand the things. So, several processes like softening, coagulation, adsorption, gas transfer, some of the pH, or they are all pH specific, because these all processes will be influenced by the pH. Softening process is also influenced by pH. Coagulation process, you require at alkaline range, if the water has to be treated with a coagulation process, the pH has to be increased. It is up to the 10, it is the pH is required for the best coagulation process. Then adsorption, gas transfer, these are also and very important methods, depends on the pH. So change in pH will cause the dissociation of ions and hence will influence the chemical reactions. So when the pH has to be maintained in a chemical process, buffer solutions, solutions which resist the change in pH will be used. So some chemicals also change their color due to the increase of specific ions at the specific pH values and are used as a indicators. So very low and very high pH values are not suitable for biological metabolism as well as bacterial growth. This is very important. Very high pH values are not suitable for biological, low as well as high. So the optimum pH should be there. So low means if it is less than 4, so not suitable for biological or metabolism growth. If pH is greater than 10, not suitable. Not suitable. Here also it is not suitable. For bacteriological or any biological process, we can say any biological wastewater treatment process. Wastewater in the 18 CV 55, before we already discussed this, which are the biological methods. One is activated sludge process and one more is tritium filter process. They are very good treatment process for the removal of organic matter from the wastewater. So then he has mentioned about some of the things about buffer solutions. You know, what are these buffer solutions? Normally, these are the solutions which resist the change in the pH of the solution, which always it will resist the change in the pH of the solutions. So, for example, even if I add some water or some alkali, but the pH will remain same. I'll take 100 ml of water, 100 ml of pH 7 buffer solution. For this, I'll add around 10 ml of pH 5 solution. then your pH will not change. pH will remain the same. That is why you can call that as
buffer solution.
If you take other than buffer solution, for example, so normal water which is having pH 7, normal water which is having the pH 7, so if you add 10 ml of pH 5 water or solution, your of course there will be a degrees in the pH, degrees in the pH.
So degrees in the pH. But in case of buffer solution, it is not going to change. So therefore, even for some of the instrument measurements and all those things, as some of the indicators, will always use the buffer solution. So why this buffer solution is required here now? So it is required for the measurement of the pH. Then how the pH can be measured?
pH can be measured by electrometric or colorimetric method.
So you might be already knowing that litmus paper is used to check the pH of the solution. That is one. There you will get just take a litmus paper and put it in any of the solutions where you are trying it. So there you can see that there will be a color change in the litmus paper. According to that, the code will be there, the indicator will be there. From here to here, this color. From 5 to 6, this color. 7 to 6, this color. So that will be there. According to that, you have to determine it. But that is a rough method.
If you see the litmus paper, so you have the graduations 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 14, you will be there. Color coding will be there. But you cannot identify if the pH is 2.1 or if it is 3.1 or it is 4.5. In between the 4 and 5, you cannot recognize it. So for that reason, the litmus paper will not be used to find out the pH of the solution. So to overcome that, the electrometric determination of pH that has been developed. So it involves the measure of electromotive force that is produced in a glass electrode system. I'll tell you how exactly it will be measured. So the EMF, that is electromotive force produced, varies linearly with pH scale. The pH meter is high impedance electrometer calibrated in a terms of pH. The pH measuring instruments is calibrated potentiometrically using standard buffer solutions. So here it has come, you can check. So we require the buffer solution to calibrate the equipment. Since the ionization of the solutions vary with the temperature corrections will be required to measure the electrometric measurements. So now, how exactly it will be measured? I'll show you. So one pH meter, will using the pH meter we are analyzing in our lab. So for that you have one calibrating knob will be there, and one more is temperature correction will be there. Okay, so then what you can do, calibration in the sense, why calibration is required, that's the first thing. Calibration, see, the calibration term, we will use it or we will do it whether the equipment is correct or not, to check the equipment is correct or not, whether the equipment is giving correct readings or not. Then how will check it out, the equipment is correct or not? Normally we'll take the known pH buffer. First we will take the known pH buffer solution, that is 7, then 4, and one more is 9. Okay, these four buffer solutions, we already know that they are 7, they are fixed.
7, 4, 9. Then
in this equipment, these are two knobs. That is, one is temperature correction, one more is calibration collection, and one more display will be here. Okay, it has to display. Then it will be connected with one electrode. Small electrode will be there. So inside, at the electrode is of the glass, at the end inside it will be calomel electrode. So one type of small electrode will be there inserted inside a glass electrode. What will happen is that it will be connected. This equipment will be connected with this glass electrodes. Glass electrodes. Then you have to take that glass electrode and you have to dip it in water, whichever the things you wanted to measure it. But before that, you have to calibrate it. Before that, the first thing what you have to do is that you have to calibrate it. So place the electrode here inside the solution, starting with pH 7. You go for pH 7 buffer solution. pH 7, pH 7 buffer, pH 7 buffer solution. Take it and insert that electrode in this. Then it has to display 7 first. If you are placing, it has to display the pH 7 on a display board. Suppose if it is not displaying pH 7, then you have the calibration knob will be there. This one is calibration knob. This one, calibration knob. Using that, you adjust it to 7. So you adjust it to 7. If it is displaying 7, no need to go for that, or no need to touch that calibration button. Then before that, before calibration, so the temperature, whatever will be there, that you have to lab temperature, whatever it will be there, that you have to fix it first. So here also on the temperature display, or here graduations will be there. So there you have to rotate it and you have to adjust the temperature knob to that. Okay, so before doing the calibration, this you have to do it. Then after that, you have to start with the pH 7 buffer solutions. So then it has to display pH 7. If it is not displaying, so using the calibration knob, then you have to adjust it to 7. You have to adjust it to 7. So this is over. Then again, place the pH 4, remove it, and whenever you are removing it, and just rinse this electrode in distilled water. So take this distilled water, then rinse that with the distilled water. Why you want to rinse with the distilled water? The main reason is that because ions of pH will be always attached to that electrodes, that you have to wash it. One or two times you have to rinse it and take the paper. Using that paper, just rub it. That smooth papers, it will come. Tissue papers, normally we can call it as a tissue papers of laboratory grade, that you have to use it. Then wipe the electrodes so that you can just remove that pH 7 buffer solutions you are already inserted to that in a beaker. Then after that, go with pH 4. Then pour the pH solutions into it and place the electrode again here. So it has to display pH 4. Suppose if it is not displaying 4, normally it will display. Most of the time it will be 3.98 or 3.99. It will be there. In back side of this equipment, small corrections you have to make it. Just rotate that back to back side of this equipment, one small button will be there. Just using the screw, just adjust it with that. Okay, then you will get 4. No need to touch this calibration button. Then again, take the solution, then place
the pH 9. Then, of course, if a two-point calibration, if you did it properly, then the third, it has to display properly. It has to display. See, once if you did the 7 and 4, these are the 2 points, 7 points and 4 points. This is a two-point calibration. So then automatically, if you insert the 9 pH buffer solution, then it has to display 9. Then the equipment is correct. Now the equipment is calibrated. After that, then you take the unknown solution, then place the electrode inside that solution. Then it will give the whatever the value of that pH of the solution. Initially, what you have to do is that you have to go with the calibration only. Then display the pH. Display the, it is going to display the pH. Okay, the same, I already told that how exactly you have to calibrate the equipment. Then I already told that 2 to 3 point calibration. So pH 4 as well as 9.2, it will be there. So that all the things you have to do it using the tissue paper that I already explained how exactly you have to measure it. So first thing in this, place the electrode sample analysis. If you want to check the known sample, unknown sample, unknown sample, if you want to or if you want to carry out the measurement of the pH of unknown sample. So after calibration, place the solution here and place the electrode here, then automatically it will just display the pH on display board. Display board. Okay. Again, normally that things will be there whenever if you come to the laboratory, I'll explain it. And this is very important. The instrument should be kept at standby position whenever the electrode is removed from the solution. Always the tip of the electrode should never be allowed to dry when the instrument is on. Or what you can do, suppose if you are not using this equipment for a long time, then place your electrode in KCl solution. Small, this one is actually KCl. This is small L. KCl solution. So of 0.1 molar. So here also what you have to do is that you prepare 0.1 molar potassium chloride solution and always dip it in, dip the electrode in that solution. So this is how you have to analyze the sample. So then we will maybe in the next class we will start with the conductivity as well as the turbidity. So why? Of course, the conductivity is also measured. Conductivity and turbidity. So conductivity as well as even it is also measured using electromotive force. Okay, what is this electromotive force? That I have not explained actually. See, whatever this pH is, work on the principle of electromotive force. See, I already said that H plus ions. H plus ions are responsible for creating the force in terms of signals. So what will happen is that, see here, the pH you have H plus ions are there. Here also you have H plus ions are there. Okay, what I will do is that I will dip the electrode. That I already said that it consists of the glass electrode.
gauze electrode and the calomel electrode. So inside, I said one wire will be there. See, what will happen is that when this H plus ions is going to touch this glass electrode first, so then the electrons will, this is the glass electrode, so inside you have one small electrodes will be there. So when H plus ions will attach, or so it will send the signal to this electrode, means sending the signal means some force, that is electromotive force created by the H plus ions in terms of electrons, it is going to send the signals that I have 10 H plus ions. So display the pHs 5. So I have the pH, I have H plus ions 100. So then display pH as 4. So like that, it is the created, the force created by the electrons of the H plus ions. So again, if I want to explain how exactly electrons, protons and neutrons. So electrons always it will, so you have in an atom you have the electrons, protons, and neutrons will be there, but the main thing is also an atom, or it is an element, so which is creating the electromotive force when you dissolve it in water. So of course this electrometric method we will use it for determination of this pH. The similar principle is involved in the conductivity. Even conductivity is also measured using the conductivity meter, similar to the pH meter. Here also the electromotive force is developed by the ions. The principle is almost similar, and here also you have to go with the calibration technique. In both the case you have to calibrate first, so this you have to do it with a known standard conductivity, with a known standard turbidity values. Okay, these two we will try to complete in the next classes. So here also calibration will be there. So for conductivity, what we'll do is that we'll take known KCl solution, then for turbidity also we'll take, it is measured in NTU, so here also we'll take the known turbidity value solutions. So then how this one more thing I left, how buffer solution is prepared in our laboratory. So you will get a pH tablets nowadays. Just 10 years back, if you want to prepare the pH buffer solution, it is very tedious. Now pH tablets, it will come in terms of pH 4 tablets, pH 7, pH 9 tablets it will come. What you have to do is that you have to take one tablet 4, then dissolve it in 100 ml of distilled water. So dissolve it in 100 ml of distilled water. Again, pH 7 tablet you take it and dissolve it in 100 ml of distilled water. You have to use distilled water only. Okay, even take, if you want to prepare the pH 9, you take that buffer powder will be there in it is there in the pH tablets, then you have to use that. Dissolve it in 100 ml, so you will get the pH 7 buffer solutions. Okay, so that is the only thing, the preparation of the chemicals for pH experiment. So other things also, that is for conductivity, so you have to know, prepare the known conductivity, 0.1 molar, how much conductivity it will give, 0.2 molar, how much conductivity will give, the set of known standard solutions it will be there. That you have to calibrate it and you have to measure the conductivity as well as turbidity. The remaining we will discuss in the next class.